seven names, no games as I run it down the line. We got Kenny Ken, put 100 on the tees with the streak for the cash. He ESPN, Seth Curry with the shot. The prodigy. In reality, he's more like Seth, but he's all we got. Up next is Gentleman Jack, better known as Junior Blue. We told him not to do it anyway, but he did what he do. To his right is Devin, that dude, L Dad or Dirt Ass Dan. Just don't ask him a question, cause then he'll answer your question with another question, and then he'll add another question on top of that question. Damn. And I'm Red O, the Buck Wild Problem Child.
Flow Butter, aka John Cutter.
It's the league ambassadors, and we playing to win at the 2-yard line. And make no mistake, we running it in.
Thank you for visiting 32 Kings Road. I'm Ambassador Kenny Ken, and it is my pleasure to be here today with my brothers.
Sure enough.
This is episode 36, season 2 of our show, 32 Kings Road. And on today's show, this will take us to the next level, or it will take us to the next level.
Thanks for waiting for me to come back.
We are going to have a discussion, a very humorous discussion, about race matters in the NFL. I'll just say that. NFL race matters. We'll also cover our hot topics, go over some week 13 picks, fantasy recommendations. As a reminder, you can follow us everywhere on social media. Our handle is @TheLeagueAM. That's Twitter, that's Facebook, that's Instagram. Also, please check out our website, TheLeagueAM.com. Our YouTube channel, League Ambassadors. Please share, subscribe, download all of our podcasts. Let's get this show going. Dad, what you sipping on, baby?
Yes, sir. So I'm sipping on some Stella.
Yep.
What I'm really sipping on, and I say this tongue-in-cheek, that I root for a team that is actually in the playoffs, and I'm one of the only league ambassadors that can say that.
I said that last week, Devin. Why are you bringing it up again?
Because we're still in the motherfucker. We are sex, but we in, so fuck it, we going with it.
Junior Blue, what you sipping on?
I'm drinking some Hennessy tonight.
Yes.
And what I'm sipping on is Mr. Can't Get Right is back in the league.
Josh Gordon.
Yes.
That's the dope man.
So what do they do?
10 G's a month.
They put a microphone in his face, and he sits down at an interview and says, you know what? When I was at Baylor, I was getting 6 pounds a week, making about 10K a month.
Tell the truth.
Hey, shut up and catch the ball.
Please, and do it a lot this week, because I got you in fantasy.
It wasn't no boosters for me. I was my own booster.
That sounds. But you know what? That sounds like that AA.
It's clear.
It's one of the steps.
Yes, confession. He's at the confession level. Kev, what you sipping on?
Hey, in that instance, we really need him to stick to sports. Tonight, I'm sipping on what's left of this Corona Extra. It's keeping me hydrated. I wanted to start by saying rest in peace to Mr. Shawn Michael Maurice Taylor, who was murdered 10 years ago yesterday. The great Washington football team safety who, had he not died, he could have been top three, top five safeties of all time. So, you know, it's just unfortunate to look back on his life 10 years later. But what I'm really sipping on, and I want to ask you guys.
Greg Williams ain't been the same since.
If you've heard about the bird, because this past weekend, the bird around the NFL, the Ravens, the Cardinals, the Falcons, and the Eagles, all won. And I'm proud to be a member of that flock.
Bird is the word.
Well, I'm a member of the 3-0 flock. How about that? We got and thanks to the Ravens, they were part of it. I gave you three last week. They all hit. We're going to keep the momentum going. We're 18-11-1, so I'm still over 500. But we push for perfection. Let's start. Let's stay with the Birds. Let's go Philadelphia and Seattle. Okay, Seattle is a home underdog. 5-point underdog. Tease that line up to 12 and take Seattle. We'll get into the details a little bit later. Then we've got Indianapolis versus Jacksonville. tease the spread down to 2.5. I believe Jacksonville is a 9.5-point favorite. Tease it down 2.5. Take the Jags. Indianapolis is done. And then we've got Minnesota and Atlanta. Minnesota, 3-point underdog on the road. They just got a huge road win on Thanksgiving against Detroit. Tease that line up to 10 and take Minnesota. Minnesota has one of the best defenses in football. They've got great corners. I gave you Julio Jones last week in fantasy. Going to be a different situation for him this week. Take Minnesota to cover that 10-point spread. So that's Seattle home dogs, take them. Minnesota road dogs, take them. And then take Jacksonville to cover the 2.5 line spread. Put $100 down and thank the league ambassadors.
Are you going
to
take that mulligan on favorite, though?
Am I
he was waiting to pull it.
Am I going to take that mulligan on favorite?
You butchered it when you tried to say favorite.
Oh, did I?
Yeah. It was well, like 45 seconds ago.
I waited patiently.
Hey, that's because I'm sipping on double Coronas. Red-O, what you sipping on, baby?
Yo, I'm sipping on Hawaiian Punch because Hawaiian Punch has a lot of shit in it. And that's what's in my cup.
Mm-hmm.
Last couple days hasn't been good for a couple coaches. Mm-hmm. Two different sports. It was yesterday, right, with David Fizdale.
Memphis Grizzlies head coach.
Memphis Grizzlies basketball, NBA.
Mm-hmm.
So you guys know how I feel. I have never been a proponent of players having more power than the coach. So when David Fizdale gets fired yesterday. I mean, the Grizzlies are 7-12, but they should be 7-12 because they're, as Devin would put it, their lineup is sex. They have a decent...
An interesting word choice at this particular time.
Hey, buddy.
Hey, Mr. Fizdale.
We're going to get to that. they have a descending center who's... I don't want to say he's past his prime, but he is no longer ascending.
Mm-hmm.
They have a point guard who is, at one point, was the highest paid player in the league, and he should be the 30th highest paid player in the league.
And he stays injured. He's injured right now.
And his wife had an affair.
Oh, God.
All right.
Baby ain't got no darker yet.
Keep going.
It's going to be a light-skinned running back.
foreshadowing.
Hey, and they got athletes in their family now.
Yeah, they sure do.
Daddy was a super athlete, so let's
go. I'm going to keep it going, though. Fizdale was a part of the Miami Heat. He was an assistant coach of Miami Heat when there was a new coach, Eric Spoelstra, who coached LeBron harder than he's ever been coached. LeBron wanted Spoelstra fired. Pat Riley came down and said, no, this is your coach. They won an NBA championship after that. So this is what Fizdale has seen. So when last year there was a souring between Marc Gasol and Fizdale, and it has never been repaired. Last game, Fizdale benched Marc Gasol in the fourth quarter against lowly Brooklyn at that. So 2 days later, he's fired. The GM actually comes out and says... That was part of the reason because of his...
He skated around. He didn't want to say that was the full reason, but he said it had something to do with it,
which is why you are Memphis Grizzlies, because you should never, unless that person is Michael Jordan, Kobe Bryant, LeBron James...
Magic Johnson did it. I was going to ask you, so you're not a proponent of him.
He fits in those names.
Yeah. No, but that's what I'm saying. Like, there are maybe 10 players in history who should have had the cachet.
To make that call.
Yes.
Marc Gasol is not one of those guys.
And has never been one of those guys.
You put both the Gasols together,
neither one. Right.
And all you need to know about what happens is when the players react. And no one talked about Marc Gasol. There were multiple players in the league who supported Fizdale, who was a coach. You know, players usually back players.
Mm-hmm.
They back the coach.
Mm-hmm.
Mainly because, you know, Fizdale is...
He's liked in the circle.
Yes, and he is one of those people where everybody knows he's a good coach, and I guarantee he will land somewhere, Thibodeau. He will land somewhere in the NBA next year. But even then, he is all right. He is going to be all right. And I actually think... GM Chris Wallace fired him And players, some of the players on the team hated him because his wife is sexier and more beautiful than everybody else's wife.
Everybody.
Jesus Lord. Now, the second coach, I said he gonna be all right. Now, this one we're gonna talk about. Tennessee Vols athletic director John Curry. First of all, he shit the bed. He tried to go after John Gruden because his wife was a ex cheerleader for Tennessee. John Gruden said, "Nah, I'm good. I'm gonna keep this $10 million that they paying me to sit in this booth."
Right.
Everybody knew he was not going to be a Tennessee coach. He wasn't coming out of retirement. So then he goes to his backup, which is Mr. Greg Schiano. So basically, they come to an agreement. Then the alumni, the students, the boosters, they lose their collective mind.
The White House, the White House chief of staff,
all Tennessee came out.
They lose their collective mind. Say this man cannot be our coach. So I'll get into the reason in a second. So John Curry, he buckles and he says, "You know what? I'm gonna back out of this agreement. There was no contract signed." So if you don't know who Greg Schiano is, Greg Schiano was a assistant coach for a lot of teams. He's been a head coach at Rutgers, Rutgers and Tampa Bay Buccaneers. He turned around Rutgers program.
He did not turn around the Tampa Bay Buccaneers.
Okay, so this is the reason why Greg Schiano is no longer the Tennessee Vols coach and why he never signed his contract. Because back in 91, Schiano became an assistant coach at Penn State. And if you're not familiar with the name Jerry Sandusky,
Sandusky.
He was Sandusky was a assistant coach for Joe Paterno at Penn State from 1969 to 99. I mean, that's a fucking long ass time to be an assistant coach. But basically, long story short, Sandusky was playing hide the pickle with little boys.
Oh my God.
Keep going.
He was. He was charged with 52 counts of sexual abuse over a 15-year period. Last year, there was a,
deposition
civil that deposition. Came out that said Greg Schiano walked in on Jerry Sandusky.
Which was actually a really bad game of telephone, is what it was in the deposition.
Well, someone told someone
that someone else saw him
that
do
someone,
that.
That's, that
but Greg, here's the thing, like, regardless, I get that. It's really bad game of telephone, but his name was mentioned as seeing him.
Right, but no one ever followed up on it, and no one investigated to prove that that's the case. So it's basically mudslinging, and you don't take... People are in an uproar of some shit that was never actually...
It's not even... It's more... I guarantee you, it's more of what just happened with Rob Moore.
Yeah, I mean, that has a
Alabama
part to play
senator.
In it.
And I
Tennessee, Alabama.
Right.
Are you guys catching a drift in the UK? If not, spin the globe.
I don't know. Do they know where that they're located close to each other?
Spin the globe.
Do they have any idea that they're close to each other? But first of all, the AD needs to be fired. If you're going to make the hire and you believe, because he's doubling down. Greg Schiano has nothing to do with the Gary Sandusky case. So if he has nothing to do with the Jerry Sandusky case, then he should be your coach.
Gary or Jerry, he ain't got nothing to do with neither one of them.
Right.
He was waiting, wasn't you?
He was waiting, weren't you?
Pew, pew.
Got him.
Kev's trying to jump?
It's unfortunate because at the end of the day, we all, you know, end up taking a back seat to the court of public opinion. And, you know, to what extent does a decision maker decide that, okay, we have to scale this back because of what the fan base thinks? I mean, this was something that we saw Ravens owner Steve Bisciotti go through with the whole Colin Kaepernick situation. But I think it sucks. Like you said, like a game of telephone, somebody can just put like a rumor out there, and whether or not it's true or not, now he has to defend that, whether he goes to Tennessee or goes anywhere else. That's something that's always going to be up against him when he's looking for a coaching job.
I think it's a combination of discontent in our society and social media, that now the proverbial cart is driving the horse.
And delusions of grandeur.
And what coach is going to want to coach for them now?
Guess what? No one.
No one.
They just offered the job to Duke's head coach.
Cutcliffe.
And he says no.
Who's from UT? Who's from UT? He said no. Mike Gundy, I'm a man. Oklahoma State. He said, I'm a cowboy for life. I don't want the job. Yeah. They tried to get Jason Witten, which lets you know how batshit crazy they must be. He's still playing. What do you think he's going to put the hang the cleats up to go be the he's never coached before.
Never recruited.
Never recruited. Hasn't even seen the NCAA rule book and how thick it is. And you think he's going to be the head coach? They are outside of their minds right now.
Yeah.
At this rate.
First of all, he took 9 months too. He's only been on the job 9 months. He took 9 months too long to fire the previous head coach. Yeah.
It is an embarrassment for the university. I wouldn't be surprised if Peyton Manning hasn't already made the call to say, "Hey, fire this clown." Mm-hmm. They've been playing musical chairs
with the AD, the chancellor, the president.
It's all
for the
bad.
Last few years.
Peyton Manning has even tried to go back to John Gruden and recruit him. And John's like, "Nah, you tripping."
Nah, I got some. There's some NFL jobs coming up with some really good quarterbacks.
All of a sudden, he was namaste.
Right. Namaste. Yeah. All right, let's get to our interesting segment, Race Matters segment. Dev, take it away.
Shit.
So we wanted to jump into this Race Matters conversation, and we wanted to have a little bit of fun with it, though. So just to give you some context of where we're going with this, Kobe Bryant, in his last season, admonished his teammate Jordan Clarkson for going to the hole like a light-skinned dude. So basically what that means is
Kobe!
Say it again. He went to the hole.
Like a light-skinned dude.
Kobe!
That's a direct quote from Kobe, too. So that means that basically he was going up weak, that light-skinned brothers, when they play ball.
Soft.
Or
he
soft.
He basically called him a bitch.
Basically. So I took real offense to that because I'm of the light-skinned tribe.
I ain't
nobody bitch.
But are you an addict, though?
No. So I began to think about that because, you know, again, I took offense to it, and we have this football podcast, and you can't be soft and play football, one would think, and there are light-skinned players that play. So I wanted to take a look at one of the glory positions over the years. And
Blackest.
And kind of see where my tribe stands with that. Because to play that position, you have to be
light-skinned tribe?
Yeah, you have to be tough, athletic, and the good ones all have longevity.
You can't be light and slight.
Nah, you can't.
And that's the running back
position. That is the running back position. So when taking a look at it, I saw a lot of trends. Some interesting ones. So many trends that we created some fucking categories for these guys. So the question is, and then we'll get into it, is where are the light-skinned running backs? Yeah. So we're going to go down the list here and try to find some.
And who?
And then we're going to place them in our categories that we created that we'll get into. And if there's any disagreement at all, we will look to the Lord of Light.
Shit.
Ambassador Chef Curry.
Mr. Daywalker himself.
Who is the king of the Daywalkers.
He's golder than gold.
Yeah. He's the deciding factor, and his say is final.
The light skin overseer.
That is it. So I want to start. And then
my daddy would say, real bright, damn near white.
Yep. So I just want you guys to jump in when someone is light skin. Just yell light skin. All right. So we're going down from the top rushers of all time. Emmitt Smith, Walter Payton, Barry Sanders, Curtis Martin, LaDainian Tomlinson, Jerome Bettis.
I got a question on him.
Frank Gore. Ain't no question on him. Eric Dickerson. Tony Dorsett.
I got another question on him.
Jim Brown.
He might have some questions himself. He can't remember.
Marshall Faulk. Adrian Peterson. Edrin James. Marcus Allen.
We stopping right there.
That's 14 on the list.
Yeah, Marcus Allen. We gonna stop right there.
Why?
He got green eyes. Let me tell you something. If you have any sort of light complexion and you have one of two things, you're light skin. That's either light eyes or some sort of silk in your hair. Marcus Allen got light green eyes. He's light skin. We can start there.
Wait, there are Africans with light green eyes.
We not talking about where you from. We're talking about where not we talking about light skin.
So
look at that. Look around them eyes.
He is not light-skinned.
That's light-skinned.
So I think he's light skinned. Les?
No.
Kev?
Is he light skinned?
I am the decider.
His children are.
Marcus Lamar Allen is indeed light skinned.
Yes!
Wow.
Can y'all point it? Yes, he has green eyes. My daddy got green eyes. He's light skinned.
he's darker than your daddy.
Now, listen, he is, but Marcus Allen grew up on the West Coast, played on the West Coast, so that sun has impacted
that
him.
He got a little tan.
Exactly. And look, and I think one of the deciding factors here is we have to look at his relationships. You know, not just in romance, but friendships.
You mean Al Davis' daughter?
Catherine Edwards at O.J. Simpson's house. Then it was alleged that Mr. Allen may or may not have had an affair with Nicole Brown. And I feel like if you date America's treasure, that automatically makes you light-skinned.
So Seal is light-skinned?
No. So he's not a debate. But staying in the same vein, so Mr. Marcus Allen fell into the category that we created. He's a hog.
Yes.
Basically, anyone in this category is someone that basically is a Hall of Famer. So aside from Mr. Marcus Allen, we also have Jerome Bettis and Tony Dorsett.
Now,
Jerome Bettis.
I say Jerome Bettis is light-skinned because if you find the right picture,
the right picture.
And thank you, Les, that's the right picture, that to me looks light-skinned.
That is a brown-skinned man, and you know it. Stop playing.
Kevin?
Jerome Bettis is indeed dark skinned because light skinned dudes don't use Beijing.
So, if we're gonna lose, we just let it go, right?
I don't know if he dark skinned. He ain't light skinned.
All right, so what about Mr. Dorsett?
Again, I mean,
come on, man.
Tony Dorsett?
He is not light skinned. Like, who is making these rules?
That's a bad picture. You know who it is. That's a bad picture.
He looks like a runaway slave in that picture. Like, he is not light skinned.
That's a bad picture.
And he will kick your ass in the ring.
No, you're thinking about Herschel Walker.
Oh, shit.
We're talking about that.
That's still not light skinned.
Kevin.
Hey.
Kevin.
No, the edges. Look at the edges. Kevin, receding hairline.
Tell him he's
Kevin, take
skin.
That crown off, and Devin, take your hat off.
He's not even close to light skin.
Listen, Tony Dorsett is indeed not light skin.
Thank you.
He married a sister.
That is our defining
point.
Our defining point here.
This is not going to be right. All right. That's the defining rule.
So Marcus Allen is the only hog. Only light-skinned hog. There's some other there's one other Hall of Famer that I'm looking at, but we got a different category for him.
Yeah, so we're going to jump into another category here.
Yep.
And we felt like after going down the list that there's a couple things that jump out. So we got a category called white boys because there's some good-ass white boy running backs, and that's a position that they don't normally play.
Mm-hmm.
So with them, we have Larry Zonka, who was a beast.
A beast.
John Riggins.
Played on the classic team. Yes, Mr. Riggins.
Who was a freight train. And then we also have, for some reason on this list, Mr. Franco Harris.
I put Franco on there. I did it.
Hold on.
Franco.
What? My daddy would say,
hey,
real bright.
Yep.
Damn near white.
Damn near white.
I remember there was a time where it was 1/16th and you was black. Yeah. Mr. Franco Harris is half and half. Kevin, even though this is the white boy segment or section, Franco Harris.
Franco Harris definitely qualifies in this category.
Yes.
He played for the Steelers, so I can't give him any credit here. But if you ask me, I think John Riggins might be the blackest. He drank E&J for 60% of the games that he played in. So we gotta put Riggs over that hump.
Right. So we're gonna there's a couple of things that we want to discuss and while staying on, and this sounds crazy, but while staying on white boys.
Yes.
We're gonna talk about another diva position within the sport, which is the wide receivers. So these receivers tend to be some of the best athletes in the world with their speed, agility, and the things that they can do. Mm-hmm. Like Hopkins last night, just ridiculous.
DeAndre Hopkins is nasty.
He's nasty. Now, a lot of the all-time greats, and this is another position that tend to be occupied by black guys.
Mm-hmm.
But there's some bad white boys out there.
That's right.
And the thing that I wanted to bring to light is a lot of times when you talk about white receivers, they're always described the same way, scrappy, high motor, you know, they're always coachable, you know, players. So we're going to kind of do this like our Mount Rushmore segment that we would do with our history pieces. Now, there were some universal picks that all of us came up with. So we all created our own receiving core of four receivers.
What's the name of this segment again? This one?
This is called...
This is race matters, but we just...
No, this one, where we at right now?
This is white boy receivers.
White boy receivers.
All white receiving core.
We're so fucking racist.
No, we're not.
No.
I'm sipping on this shit.
So... With that, there are three that we kind of came a consensus with across the cores. And that's Mr. Ricky Pearl, Fred Biletnikoff, and Steve Largent.
Mm-hmm.
So pretty much everybody had them across the board. So I know, Les, you had a lot of them within your core.
Right. Yeah, I definitely did. I know there was one that I didn't that... nobody else had, and that was Lance Allworth.
Mm-hmm.
Drafted by the Raiders, traded to the Chargers. That was a bad move. Because
you can only have one top-notch white receiver in the organization.
And the thing about him, though, a lot of the offenses, the wide receivers now play the same way he played back in the 60s and 70s. He had 542 receptions, over 10,000 yards, and 85 touchdowns, and was a Super Bowl champion. It's one of those things where he was one of the best receivers at the time, and that team, the Chargers, changed the game.
Wasn't he a contemporary of Biletnikoff?
Yes, definitely.
Who are you taking, Biletnikoff or Allworth?
Wait, wait, hold on. Answer that question.
Biletnikoff?
Okay, just checking.
He thought I was going to pronounce it wrong.
No. I was seeing if he was going to take the Raider or not.
Oh, no, he was definitely. Yeah, definitely was going to take him. He was on my list, and he was on yours too. Yeah. So
he nice.
What's special about Biletnikoff?
He just think about his numbers in a ground and pound era. You know, there wasn't receivers that had the numbers that he had during that time,
mm-hmm.
and plus
mm-hmm.
he could catch everything.
Yeah, I mean, there's a freaking award in college
right
after him.
That's right,
for the receivers.
Yep.
So, I mean, he's a bad man. A lot of us also had Steve Largent.
Yeah. That, you know, Steve Largent. I knew about Steve Largent because, again, I was one of those kids that looked at box scores, looked at the back of trading cards. And Steve Largent was every step of the way with Jerry Rice. Mm-hmm. And, you know, just a dominant figure for the Seattle Seahawks.
I mean, was he the first receiver to get to 100 touchdowns?
He was. Yeah.
So he was a bad man.
Yeah.
Now, Kev, go ahead.
When he retired, he had the most career catches,
most
career touchdowns, most yards, and a 177 game streak with at least one catch when he retired.
For the Seahawks,
who I can't think of one quarterback that was playing for them except I think maybe
Dave
at the tail end.
Dave Craig.
Well, I was going to say Rick Meyer, I think towards the very end.
I don't know if he played with him. That might have been.
That might have been a couple years.
Really? I think so. We researched that.
Well, Kev, you also had Steve, but you actually had a lot of different players on your core. So talk about that, your three others.
Yeah, indeed. And I had Largent, and in the three other picks, I went with my favorite white wide receivers for personal reasons. I went with Mr. Raymond Barry, who played for the original Baltimore Colts, two-time champion. Led the league in catches three times, receiving yards three times, receiving touchdowns three times. And he had, in the greatest game ever played, he had 12 catches, 178 yards, and a touchdown. So I couldn't leave Baltimore without mentioning Mr. Barry. I also had Brandon Stokely, who is the best wide receiver that Ozzie Newsome has ever drafted. we're going to give him credit there. He won a Super Bowl here with the Ravens and then went to Indy and won with Peyton Manning. But he was one of three receivers on that 04 team that all had 1,000 yards each.
Marvin Harrison, Reggie Wayne.
Oh, he said
Don't say his name, Kenyon.
Sorry.
Don't say his name.
Harvin
Marison.
Sorry.
Yeah, and they
we were already fucking up with this show.
Sorry.
And then I went with Ed McCaffrey, who, before the Ravens got here, I admit I was a huge Denver Broncos fan. He's a three-time Super Bowl champ, once with San Francisco, twice with the Broncos. Went to the Pro Bowl in 98. He had 101 catches in 2000. And along with teammate Rod Smith, they were the second duo of our receivers on the same team to have over 100 catches in the same year. So I had to give the tall Ed, man. Couldn't nobody stop him.
That dude was tough.
For real.
He used to get rocked.
Well, he was 6'5 coming across the middle. You couldn't miss him.
He was getting rocked.
Playing against Steve Atwater.
And he got good genes. He got good genes too. He's over there breeding. He's with the Torres clan and breeding.
Well, that's funny.
Shout out to Coach Joe.
sticking with pass catchers. There's also a running back segment for that we have a section. Mm-hmm. So we want to get back to the running back thing here. And again, Kevin's the overseer. So for pass catching. Running backs. These are running backs that, you know, were utilized out of the back foot, obviously. We have Mr. Matt Forte, Roger Craig, and Warrick Dunn. let's start with the obvious here. Matt Forte, light skin?
Yeah, there's no question Matt Forte is light skin.
He is a strong light skin. Strong.
What is a strong light skin, Omar? What does that mean?
That's when you drinking red Kool-Aid.
No doubt. He's a no doubter. All right, so then we have Mr. Roger Craig.
Yeah, I mean, the picture I saw, I thought he was light skin. Is he light-skinned, Kevin?
I don't think Roger Craig had any light-skinned tendencies, though. You know, I couldn't find the
way. He lives in San Francisco.
Shit. That's not at this point, though. I mean, he's out there.
That's light-skinned. Less. That's light-skinned, brother. And he smokes cigarettes. If you can tell that they smoke cigarettes, you're light-skinned automatically.
I'll give you that one, Kenyon.
Smoking cigarettes.
I will say he is borderline, but I wouldn't call him light.
I got a borderline. And then we got Warrick Dunn again.
Which Kenyon, you need to be
you have Warrick Dunn.
You have Warrick Dunn.
Listen, again, my rule is if you have some sort of light skin tone and you have one or the other,
but
light
he doesn't
eyes.
Have a light skin tone.
He does.
He does not.
Let's find a different picture. He does. If you got any sort of silk, some silk in your hair.
Kevin, please save us.
He's had a jerry curl and he's got waves. Not only that.
I'll put up all the pictures.
He's from Louisiana. Oh,
so Kevin. What?
He got Cajun in him.
Kevin.
Nah, I needed Kenyon to explain that because there's no way Warrick Dunn qualifies as being light-skinned. And
brown.
Here's my reason why. He ran and excelled in track and field, and there's not one light-skinned ever. Uh-huh. Except, watch the Olympics. Name one light-skinned track and field runner. You won't find one.
I got two.
Not to mention my answer's final. Name a light skinned dude that went to Florida State. Come on now.
Ooh.
Come on.
That's another show.
Damn.
Aguayo.
No, he's the kicker. Spanish. So let's move on to another another segment here.
He ain't even light skinned.
So we also have the addicts. Of our running backs. So we have Mr. Robert Smith.
Kevin Cedric, already sweating.
Cedric Benson and Tiki Barber.
Say those names again.
Robert Smith. Mm-hmm. Let's just start with that.
Mm-hmm.
Cedric Benson is not light skinned.
Cedric Benson?
Do we even have to pull up Robert
Smith? No, we don't have to pull up Robert Smith. And if you don't know why he's an addict, Google Robert Smith and DUI. And we'll see you next week.
Jesus, Lord.
Cedric Benson.
Cedric Benson
is not light skinned. Kenyon.
Come on, dog. Like, Kenyon is like anybody who's lighter than me.
It was like. Okay, it was like 12:45.
All right. Yeah.
Nah, Cedric's not light skinned. We're not
going
to do that to him.
He ran like he was light skinned.
See? That's what I was going for, Omar.
So then there's Tiki Barber.
Tiki Barber. Now, let's be real about it. He was an addict. He was addicted to fumbling. And he was also addicted to, as Kevin said, America's treasure.
High and tight. High and tight.
And that's light.
He fixed one of them. He fixed one of those addictions.
He's
not light-skinned. Oh, he is not light-skinned.
Kevin.
Who's doing this?
Kenyon, I'm with you on this.
Thank you.
Ronde ain't light-skinned.
No.
They twins.
Tiki went Hollywood.
Look.
He flew too much, and he went Hollywood.
That's a great picture, Les. That's a great picture.
So the verdict is he's light-skinned.
He went Hollywood. Tiki is light-skinned, yes.
Oh, my God. All right. So going back to receiving core here, Mr. Ace here, you had... You also had you had Ricky Pro, who we talked about.
Well, we didn't talk about
him. We didn't talk about
him. Six teams, 16 years. Again, looking at the back of the card, this meant, first of all, he got notoriety. People caught on to him because he was a part of the greatest show on turf in the slot. He was a game-winning touchdown in the 99 NFC Championship game.
Two Super Bowl TDs.
But he, look at his Phoenix, not Arizona, Phoenix Cardinal numbers. Yeah. He was killing.
He was good. Yeah,
and you guys called Dave Craig for Seattle. I challenge you to name a quarterback of his for Phoenix.
He was arguably the fourth receiver on the St. Louis team.
And by the way, Meyer missed Largent by 4 years.
Oh, okay.
Oh, there it is. Close. Yeah.
But yeah, you also, I also had had Pro because he was nasty. But you had some interesting names clutch. On your list too.
Wayne Krabet, we'll start there. If we're looking Ricky Pro on the slot.
I almost had him.
Slot on the left side. Wayne Krabet, slot on the right side. The real life Rudy. He was a Division I AA walk-on. Mm. Now chew on that. Yeah. Not 1A, 1 AA walk-on. And he went from that to being the best receiver in the New York Jets franchise history.
While Keyshawn was on the team.
Which is insane.
And he didn't wear gloves.
Hates the name
Wayne Krabet.
That's because he bought up.
The thing that's crazy though about Wayne, or not crazy, but crazy impressive, he has 580 receptions. 379 of those were for third down conversions.
Yep. Mm-hmm. Yeah, I saw that too.
Clutch. Okay, so those are my two inside guys: Ricky Pro or Wayne Krabet. Then on the outside, here's a guy named Chris Collinsworth. 7 years.
Shut the fuck up, Chris.
Here's a guy that was a three-time Pro Bowl selection. Here's a guy. He had 6,698 yards on 417 receptions. Here's a guy who was the key player in Sam Weich's run-and-gun, revolutionary K-gun offense.
One of the best offenses. One ever.
And at 6'5", here's a guy. We're talking about a guy here at 6'5", who was the ultimate in size-speed combination. He was the original Jordy Nelson. Here's a guy named Chris Collinsworth. I'm putting him on the outside. Mm-hmm. And on the other side, I'm putting the OG wide receiver, and that's Mr. Don Hudson.
Yeah.
You just want to pick names that weren't nobody else picked.
No.
He's better than Fred.
Don Hudson absolutely is.
No, I'm talking about
Chris Collinsworth. I'm taking Chris Collinsworth. He played for the Bungles.
Fred was a downfield receiver.
And so was Chris Collinsworth, who played for the Bungles, who sucked. The only reason why Chris Collinsworth isn't talked about more is because he had a devastating ankle injury. That guy was legit. But Don Hudson, 10 years, Packers, four-time Pro Bowl selection, 99 touchdowns in the 30s.
You know why I didn't pick him.
Exactly. One of the greatest receivers ever across the board.
Right. So going back to running backs, we're going to go to the miscreants, which is a word Kenyon likes to use a lot. Mm-hmm. And miscreant, light-skinned running backs, we have Larry Johnson, Ray Rice, Jamal Lewis, Corey Dillon, and OJ. Let's start with OJ.
Okay.
OJ to me is light skin. Less.
No, he's not light skin.
Oh, he didn't run away from the cops like he was light skin.
That's because of AC Cowlings. Yeah. Let's not get it twisted. His Ronald Darby.
They used to say before he ran away from the cops was he ran away from defenses like he was running away from the cops.
So he's not black. He's OJ.
That hairline is light skin. Number one. Number two,
he was light skin in the 70s.
He was Brentwood. Again, San Francisco. He's from San Francisco.
Kevin, what say you?
He lived in Brentwood.
He is not light.
Kevin.
Less said it perfect. He ain't black. He ain't white. He's OJ. He deserves his own category.
There you go. All right.
He meets every light skin category that's out there.
So. All right, Larry Johnson.
Yeah.
Light skin.
Finally.
Okay.
Gosh.
Ray Rice.
No.
Yes.
Light skin.
He's high yellow.
Less. He is not yellow.
No, he's not.
Kevin. He's not yellow.
Hey, what's your answer to this one, Kev?
Listen.
Say it out loud.
Wasn't light skin until we won the Super Bowl. He got paid. He got fat. Then he hit his girl. That's some light skin shit right there.
Boom.
Damn. I saw the video. He didn't hit her like he was light skin.
Deontay Wilder.
Jamal Lewis.
Yes. Tennessee. He spent light time skin. In a halfway house. He's light skinned.
Even if he's not, he is.
Kev, light skinned?
Jamal wasn't light skinned until he did a bid.
Right.
Came out and started running like he was light skinned.
Yeah, tipping.
He's now transformed light skinned running back.
They changed him inside.
Yeah. He got his oil changed.
He got his oil changed.
Somebody said, grab my pocket.
Oh, all right, so it's Corey Dillon. I say absolutely 100% no. Corey Dillon is not light skinned.
If the word petulant is used to describe you, I think you're light-skinned. Kevin?
Corey Dillon can't be light-skinned because light-skinned guys don't play for the Patriots unless you're Terry Glenn, rest in peace. But name a light-skinned Patriot. They're either white or black as shit.
I need you to find me another picture, Les.
That's the one.
Negotiated.
You can't.
That's the one.
Actually, you know what? I'll take that picture. Look at the light.
Look at the arms. You can tell by the arms, man.
Nah.
That's dope.
Nah.
And he meant dope.
So, yeah. So another category we have is deuce and a quarter.
Deuce and a quarter.
And that basically means a light-skinned running back that was in a committee situation. So for deuce and a quarter, we have Deuce McAllister, Deuce Staley, D'Angelo Williams, and Jonathan Stewart.
The fact that we had two deuces in the deuce and a quarter.
Right.
So let's start backwards here. D'Angelo Williams is not light-skinned.
No.
If you have pink hair, you light-skinned. Kevin has red hair.
Wait, hold on. He had pink hair?
Yes.
He's fucking light-skinned.
Thank you.
He went to the hole like Kev. He was light-skinned.
Kev.
Kenyon, this shit's natural. Second off, you dye your locks pink. As black as he is, that's some light-skinned shit.
And he dyed his tips.
The
fact that you said tips.
Yes.
It's fucking lights.
His teammate that he actually shared with is also on this list, which is he's definitely not light skinned.
He got light eyes. Check out his eyes. Check out his
Did he dye his hair?
No.
Nah, he ain't
Kevin.
Good.
But check out the hairline.
Only one of his.
Jonathan Stewart runs straight. He is definitely not light skinned.
Rincon special.
So then our last category we have is fantasy freaks, which are...
So we agree that Deuce and Deuce are light-skinned?
Yeah, Deuce and light-skinned. Yeah, come on.
Who is better? Who's the better Deuce?
McAllister.
For a short period of time.
Coming out of Ole Miss, he definitely was.
No, Deuce was the only one of the two that started.
But there was a time where Deuce was ridiculous.
This is so funny that we keep saying Deuce. No, it's his ass name.
Deuce was better.
Yeah, Deuce was better than the other Deuce.
That one.
That one.
That one. No, I think they're both light-skinned.
No, we know they're light-skinned. I just wonder which one's better.
McAllister.
That's what I meant. McAllister was for. There was a time where he was the best running back in the league.
Yeah.
Just for a short period of time.
Yeah, because he had injuries. He was injury-prone. Deuce Staley played.
Yeah.
You're right. He did.
So, fantasy freaks, these are guys that were... They were almost hogs, but they definitely filled up stat sheets when it came down to fantasy.
Right.
So we have Eddie George, Priest Holmes, Arian Foster, Amon Green, and Wendell Tyler. So Eddie George.
Well, Eddie George is light skinned only if he wants to be, because I'm not fucking with him. He's a big man.
Yo, he does not fit inside of the booth. I saw him at Roscoe's while I was in high school. That was like 20 years ago.
Fucking with Eddie.
He didn't fit in the booth.
And he married a dark-skinned sister from SWV.
Any running back that can't... Because the running back posture, you're supposed to bend your knees and put your hands on your knees. His legs are so long, he literally stood straight in the backfield like
and
he was pitching a tent.
He ran straight up and still ran over people.
Yes, he did.
So Kev, Eddie George is light-skinned.
Eddie George, thank you.
Okay.
Not if he doesn't want to be.
I don't care. Kev, we can call Ray Lewis.
Kev.
Nah, Eddie George is light skin on the surface, but everything about that man is black back to the pride line. He never hit the hole soft, and I'm not gonna pause after.
All right,
he's Lion King pride rock.
Priest Holmes, who I don't believe is light skin.
Okay, you got to pull up the right picture. So
let me go with that.
No,
shit.
NBC Sports. Pull up NBC Sports.
He Omar, has a Priest Holmes light skin.
He's got a short haircut. You see his light eyes.
Less Priest Holmes.
Dark skin. Definitely.
Right, pull up a picture.
While Les is trying to get that, Kev, can you weigh in on this?
A specific. Yeah, exactly. Keep scrolling.
Listen, at first I thought Priest Holmes was light skin because only a light skinned dude can lose his starting job to another light skinned dude.
Oh, shit.
But then I did some research and found out that the priest did marry his sister. is of course a light skin prerequisite if you don't. So no, priest is definitely not light skin. He's a brother.
No. Let me tell you something. Any man that lost my shot. There, come on. Any man that smiles like that with white hands wrapped around him is light skin.
That's uncomfortable. that picture looks like he's uncomfortable.
Mm. All right, Arian Foster. We all in agreement that he's light skin.
He's vegan.
He's vegan.
And he went vegan while he was playing football. Yeah,
his ankles are light skin.
Oh, his hamstrings are light skin too.
Amon Green, I disagree. I don't think he's light skin.
If you got a widow's peak, a new rule. If you got
Kevin, we rocking with that? We rocking with that? No, widow's peak.
Let me see this picture.
That's a great point by Kenyon. I can't argue that.
Widow's peak, baby.
You know how many people have widow's peaks?
I got one.
Shit. He got. That's light. First of all, look at that.
That makes me light skin.
Look at that picture. That's light skin.
Mike, put it up.
Go to Les. Or just hand it to me. Oh, there we go.
Yeah, that's light skin.
Oh, nah.
Receding hairline and widow's peak.
I need
peak.
To see a different picture.
That's two for two.
All right. He could either be African. Or light skin.
Last on this segment, we'll go Wendell Tyler.
Who the fuck is Wendell Tyler?
I was gonna say, who in here knows who Wendell Tyler is? Wendell Tyler was a killer for the San Francisco 49ers.
His son is light skin.
His son is definitely light skin. Mark Tyler. So by virtue of that, number one,
if his son's light skin,
he's light skin. But he was a killer for the Niners.
Yeah, if you pass along the light skin gene, you light skin.
Yeah,
but he's not light skin.
That looks like Mr. Ed.
That looks special.
He's special.
Before we move on, I know we skipped past Larry Johnson, but I do want to say, after Robert Smith, Larry Johnson is by far the most light-skinned running back in NFL history. I'm going to go buy some brief statistics about Mr. Johnson, and y'all let me know what y'all think. In 05, he had 9 consecutive games of 100 yards rushing, hottest back in the league. As soon as he got that money,
that's the right picture too.
Oh my God!
His shit started going downhill. If y'all remember, he tackled Troy Polamalu by his hair.
Yep.
That's light skin.
First of all, that picture looks light skin. Yeah. Like a light skin dude's gonna take that picture.
Look, after he got hurt, production went down. He got upset. He hit the social media, started calling out coaches.
Rock aware.
Started threatening fans.
He had an S curl in '92.
He spit on a woman at a club.
Yep.
Slapping Jaleesa.
Yep.
Yeah.
I mean, and then the final straw was, like I said, going Hollywood. He did a music video for Fantasia and for Jay-Z.
Damn. All right, so that wraps up our light skin segment here for the running back. So what we came to see is that that there's problems if your melanin is light and you running and you toting a pill.
the hand egg.
Yeah. So and before we move on to our hot topics, really quick, I pretty much had everyone in my receiving corps the same as everyone else, with the exception of. And this is just a personal favorite. I went the Kev route. I'm sorry. If I have Don Beebe as one of my core, I can put him any fucking where I want.
Yes.
I got Don Beebe, Largent, Ricky Pro, and Biletnikoff. My core isn't that tall. The tallest one is Biletnikoff at 6'1". Everybody else is around 6'5", 11".
Mm-hmm.
But I challenge you, if you, because some of you had Welker, if you swap Welker out for Don Beebe with Tom Brady, fuck out of here with
Don Beebe's a Hall of Famer.
Yeah. I don't do ifs and buts. All I know is Wes Welker caught 110 passes for 5 of 6 seasons.
No, he
straight.
Did that. He and did like, that.
Never won a Super Bowl.
Wayne Krabet, let us know where you're at. You're in the same dungeon as Zach Thomas. Yeah. I know you guys are scared of that concussion thing, but holler at us.
Yeah, and just imagine if all of our cores had the great black quarterback Warren Moon thrown to these cores.
Amazing.
What would happen?
That's reverse racism. All right, let's get to our Brexit boot bag winner, Junior Blue. It's a tandem this week.
It's a tandem, and we're going to take it back to last year, week 17, where Aqib Talib snatched the chain of Michael Crabtree. You know, he had been wearing it all year, and Talib said, I'm tired of seeing it, and he just snatched it. They played in week 4 of this season, and nothing happened, but not week 12. Week 12... all hell breaks out. We turn around, and Crabtree was ready to fight.
Yeah, he was.
A couple plays before the brawl happened, he punches Chris Harris in the stomach. And they got that on video, but he didn't get a penalty because the refs didn't see it.
Mm-hmm.
So then we have a play where Crabtree is blocking Talib. Talib thinks it went a little too long, he snatches the chain again.
Which was taped, by the way.
Yeah, a little side note, it was taped. Because he felt like this was going to happen, and he was ready to fight. It's kind of like chain snatching, girls taking off their earrings. He was ready for the fight.
That's not nice.
So, it goes, and he blocks them all the way out of bounds. They go to the ground, and on the Denver sideline, so Denver players run over. All of a sudden, Raiders players run over. Gabe Jackson bulldozes the ref. And somehow, some way, the two main Crabtree and Talib, they find themselves separated from the scrum.
Squared up. In the middle of the field.
Squared up. Well, now,
one of them had a helmet still on.
I'm a Raider fan. And I'm going to have to say Talib was the smarter of the two. He still had his helmet on.
Well, because he snatched off Crabtree's helmet.
Mm-hmm. But neither one of them could fight.
Not a lick.
Not a lick. And what turns around and happens, they get suspended for two games. It got reduced to one. Mm-hmm. And boy, oh boy, did the Raiders not attack Talib's backup. And that's why they won. So for that reason, Talib and Crabtree, you are our Brexit boot bag winners of the week.
Fucked up some fantasy with Crabtree. And I thought Cooper was going to eat, and then he got knocked out.
Crabtree will be a video of how not to fight.
Well, first, you don't punch somebody who has a helmet on.
Mm-hmm. Trey from Boys in the Hood.
Yeah, that's probably.
And keep going backwards.
Oh, they're trying to get us out of here?
Oh, you're trying to... Mike's sending us clues. Wrap it up, guys. All right, hot topics. You know, we covered hot topics a lot last week. The one biggest one, there are two things we want to cover. One, we're going to continue our If the Playoffs Were Today with Devin and Omar. Before we do that, though, came out today, Mr. Eli Manning, quarterback of the New York Giants, who I believe has a consecutive starting streak of 210 games. Not anymore. Mr. Ben McAdoo said that Geno Smith will be starting
with a straight face.
You tried.
I tried. Oh,
Geno Smith, formerly the New York Jets, will be starting on Sunday against Les's Raiders.
Another interception.
The question I have for you guys, real quick, is does this mean that Eli will be playing somewhere else next season? And if so, where, Kevin?
Absolutely. And he will be playing with his former coach, Tom Coughlin, in Jacksonville.
Okay.
Ditto. Never thought about that, but church.
That?
I think if he goes somewhere, it's Denver.
Interesting.
He wouldn't follow his brother.
Denver, Jacksonville.
Elway would.
Yeah, right.
right away.
Denver, Jacksonville, Arizona. I definitely think those are the three.
He did call the Arizona.
Look
a
at this
weeks ago.
And look at this statement. Let me tell you something. And I think it's because his name is Eli. Eli, it just, you know, you gotta always be
it's
above the fray. It sounds biblical. Because his statement was masterful. He said, you know, hey, I spoke to Ben McAdoo, and you know what? Basically, it makes no sense to keep a streak going. So if you're going to start somebody, go ahead and start them. I'll still be ready to play. This is called step one in the chess move, because in the offseason, him and Daddy is going to pay a visit to not Jerry Reese, because he'll be fired, to Mr. Mara, and they're going to call their shot and pick their destination.
Are you sure Jerry's going to be fired? Because this organization is notorious for keeping motherfuckers too long.
Well, you look at that offensive line, the fact that they haven't gotten a Warner back in 3 years, they've wasted 2 years of Eli Manning's. I think they are going to. Eli Apple, their most recent pick, is a bust. Yeah. It's going to be Mr. Ben McAdoo.
New York, you're right, because New York can say, I don't know how many times, most recent pick or signing is a bust.
Is a bust.
Yeah.
Now, you know they were the last team to start a black quarterback, right? The Giants. All 31 other teams started a black quarterback. This will be the first time.
They do have the first black Hall of Famer.
Wow.
Yeah. And Lin Tunnel.
Well, they're definitely doing it by choice.
Ooh. All right. Aredo, if the playoffs were today, walk us through. Oh, you wanted to go last. Dad. Mm-hmm. If the playoffs were today, walk us through how your playoffs turn out. Who's the Super Bowl champion?
Super Bowl champion, to me, unfortunately, is going to be the Patriots, and they will beat the Eagles.
Okay, and how did you get there?
So with the NFC, you have Eagles, Vikings, Rams, Saints, Panthers, and Falcons in that order. Wild card, Rams beat the Falcons. Saints,
really?
Yep. Saints beat the Panthers.
Okay.
Then in the divisional, Eagles beat the Saints. It's a great matchup. I want to go Saints, but we'll really find out in the next couple weeks if the Eagles are going to beat the Saints. Then you have Vikings and Rams. We already seen that movie. We just saw that. That's yeah. Vikings. And then Eagles, Vikings. The both of them only have one win against teams that are currently in the playoffs right now. So it's interesting. Outdoors in January, Eagles have a better run defense and better running backs. I stay with the home team. That's how they get out of there. AFC, Steelers, Patriots, Titans, Chiefs, Jaguars, Ravens. Titans. Huh? You heard what the fuck I said, Bears. Titans versus Ravens. I got the Ravens. We've never lost a wild card game on home or in a row with Harbaugh. I got the Chiefs. Chiefs versus the Jags. I got the Jags because the Chiefs are nosediving. Jags are better right now. In the divisional, Steelers versus Ravens, I have the Steelers. As we cannot throw the ball. That's why we can't win. We have Patriots versus the Jags. Blake Bortles. Patriots win. AFC championship game. We got Steelers at Patriots at Steelers. I have Patriots because they're playing the best ball right now.
Mike Tomlin is yeah. looking forward to that.
Yeah.
Red O, who you got?
Same thing. Patriots win a Super Bowl. I have the Titans beating the Ravens, Jags beating the Chiefs, and Steelers beating the Jags, Patriots beating the Titans, Patriots beating Steelers. AFC.
NFC.
NFC, I'm sorry. I have the Falcons beating the Rams.
Mm-hmm.
I have the Saints beating the Panthers.
Mm-hmm.
I think the Eagles lose to the Falcons.
Mm-hmm.
I think the Saints beat the Vikings.
Mm-hmm.
Falcons beat the Saints.
And the Falcons-Patriots rematch?
Rematch. And
same result.
Same result. Except this time, and it's probably the same thing. Falcons come out real strong. Halftime, Patriots make the adjustment, come back, and they kill them.
The Falcons are starting to and hum.
Then, they are. And then after they lose again, the Falcons QB, the Falcons coach, the Falcons owner can't take it anymore. They all commit suicide. The league sells the team to Donald Trump.
Oh, my God. Okay.
In Atlanta?
Only in America, baby. America. Only in America.
All right, let's get state. To our get the fuck out of here with that bullshit nominee. And it is Mr. Mike McCarthy, head coach of the Green Bay Packers. For those of you that were watching that Sunday night football game, Mr. McCarthy, there he is.
That is a great
and
picture.
That's a great picture because
is he light skin?
That's no, he's red.
He's white.
He's white. In the third quarter, they were up 21-14. He was playing outside of his mind. And they got stopped, and instead of punting and pinning the Steelers deep within their own 10-yard line, Mr. McCarthy decides that he's going to try something that's never been accomplished before in the history of Heinz Field, and that is kick a field goal longer than 53 yards.
He goes, how long was his?
57-yard field goal. Now, Mason Crosby, great, great kicker, but you are an underdog team. I believe they were 8.5-point underdogs. You're up 7 with about 3 minutes left in the third. You've got a chance to actually win this game. And instead of playing field position football like a smart coach, you want to go and try something that's never been done before. He missed the field goal. The Steelers promptly come down and score.
On a short field.
On a short field, because that's what happens when you miss a field goal.
57 yards.
Right. And the Steelers end up winning the game 31-28. Which is a difference of 3 points. Mike McCarthy, get the fuck out of here with that bullshit.
Mike McCarthy, the funny thing is, I agree with the call of who should be get the fuck out of here award winner, but that's who he is. He probably has gone for it on fourth down more than any coach in the league. And I guarantee you, he didn't know the distance at Heinz Field.
How do you not? Everyone knows going to Heinz Field.
Or if he knew, he just didn't give it. He feels like my kicker will be the first one to do it.
The wind swirls and no
three rivers. This is
yeah. That's the word is confluence. Yeah. There's a confluence of water that happens that creates a draft. Thank you. Before we get out of here, let's get to our Week 13 game picks. And fantasy recommendations. Ambassador Dad is still holding on strong with his lead of about, I think, 3 or 4 games. Although Junior Blue had a good week, he made a little bit of a move. We're all within 3-4 games, with the exception of
you,
Omar. Omar is still bringing up the rear. Game one on the agenda, we've got the Philadelphia Eagles versus the Seattle Seahawks in Seattle. As Devin already alluded to, I alluded to it with my Kenyon teases. This is a prove it game here for the Eagles. Kevin, how do you see it shaping up?
I think the Eagles prove it. Only because really? Seattle just can't. Russell Wilson can't do everything. I mean, he can do everything. But against this team, they're a pretty solid team. I don't think they have enough.
Prime time Seattle game, Redo.
Taking Seattle.
Dad.
Eagles, Seahawks just too banged up.
Agreed. Philly.
Yeah. Yeah, I'm taking the Seahawks. I think this is a Russell Wilson game. I think a key to Philadelphia has been them being able to run the ball, having that balance. A lot like the Cowboys last year, run the ball off of play action. Seahawks going to stop that run. It's going to be Carson Wentz, and I'm taking Russell Wilson. We've got Minnesota versus Atlanta, probably one of the best game or one of the best games of the weekend at home, Atlanta. They're rolling a little bit here, going against the Vikings. Minnesota, 10 days off. I like the Vikings on the road. Junior Blue.
I got Atlanta at home.
I got Vikings. Rhodes has slowed Julio down the last 2 times, and we don't know if Devontae Freeman knows where he is yet.
He doesn't.
Okay.
Yeah, but Tevin Coleman, fast, though.
Yeah.
Redo.
I'm taking Matty Ice.
Man, Omar's Super Bowl prediction got me leaning a little. I'm going to go with Atlanta here.
Okay.
You was going anyway.
Finally, we got the Carolina Panthers at home. Or not on the road, I'm sorry, against the New Orleans Saints. The past 4 games between these 2 teams, the Saints have averaged 33 points. Also, the Saints haven't lost in a Fox NFL broadcast all season. I'm taking the Saints because I watched Cam Newton a lot last week I picked up Greg Olsen. Cam is not right. He's not accurate. He's not right. Yeah. Saints win. They score too many points.
The
Junior
jokes
Blue.
Write
Saints.
Themselves.
Saints.
Saints.
I'm with the Saints.
Saints. Saints. Saints all the way, Kev?
All the way.
All right. We'll stay with you,
which
Kev.
Which means the Panthers.
Fantasy recommendations, Kev.
This was a rather easy one for me this week. I'm going with Phillip Rivers against the Browns.
Yep.
Melvin Gordon against the Browns. And Keenan Allen.
Yep. Yeah, I'm winning a fantasy title because of Keenan Allen. Book it.
I have Rivers versus Cleveland.
Oh, my God.
Fournette at Indy.
You guys are so mean.
Antonio Brown versus Cincy.
That.
Rivers, Keenan Allen, Fournette. Run it back.
Les.
Fournette. Oh. Rivers. But I have DeAndre against Tennessee, though.
DeAndre Hopkins.
That's a good one.
Yeah, he going to eat. Well, I'm way different than you guys.
They don't have a choice in Pittsburgh, so.
I thought about the Chargers versus Cleveland, but you know what? They're still playing for Hugh Jackson in Cleveland.
Hey, Myles Garrett is real.
They're still playing what? Not football.
I got Kirk Cousins going against the Cowboys.
Almost picked him.
Mike Evans going against whoever. I don't even remember. And Jordan Howard going against the Niners. I gave you Julio Jones last week, who gave you 250 yards. Stick with me, baby. This has been a fun episode of 32 Yo, Kings shoot. Road. We hope that you've enjoyed it.
If we're here next week, yes. Thank you.
Race matters all over. Follow us everywhere on social media. Our handle is at The League AM. Our website, theleagueam.com. Our YouTube channel, League Ambassadors. We will see you next week. Cheerio.
Lightandslight.com. 7 names, no games, as I run it down the line. We got Kenny Ken, put 100 on the tees with the streak for the cash. ESPN, Seth Curry with the shot. The prodigy. In reality, he's more like Seth, but he's all we got. Up next is Gentleman Jack, better known as Junior Blue. We told him not to do it anyway, but he did what he do. To his right is Devin, that dude, L Dad or Dirt Ass Dan. Just don't ask him a question, 'cause then he'll answer your question with another question, and then he'll add another question on top of that question. Damn. And I'm Red O, the Buckwild Problem Child.
Don't put an AKA John Cutter. It's the league ambassadors, and we playing to win at the 2-yard line. And make no mistake, we running it in.